Globes before.
Huh.
And I just didn't realize how gigantic it was.
Yeah.
I mean, when we left, they were tearing down all the red carpet stuff, and there must have been like 400 guys out there. And
it's huge.
Scissor lifts and giant stuff.
So do you hang around for the parties or?
No.
Not your thing.
No, we did. We actually, the thing is, at the end of it, mm-hmm. I kind of, I think because of the Martin Scorsese montage,
mm-hmm.
we kind of wanted to go watch a movie. So
that
that's
sense.
What we did.
You could go see Shutter Island, would be really perfect.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
It's exciting.
Good.
It was like, he, you know, like you, he's always doing stuff that nobody's quite expecting.
Yeah.
He and Thelma are like, you know, always coming up with edits that we haven't seen before. And
right. Experimenting.
Yeah, a lot of experimentation.
Ah, good.
You don't always expect in a big studio movie.
Yeah, no, you don't.
So that was actually the talk, I guess, of this movie for a lot of people, was that you were, you know, who else would be given $30 million to make a stop-motion animation movie about foxes who are, you know, culturally confused?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, I guess, well, also the process of doing the movie, you know, we started the movie by saying we have this Roald Dahl book we're going to do,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, it's an animated Roald Dahl thing. That seems like not a huge risk for somebody. There's a kind of reasonably low budget for an animated movie Roald Dahl thing. But then by the time we actually had our script and it was starting, it had taken on, it's, I think it was probably more unusual film by then, so I don't know.
So, I mean, was all that drama about the process disturbing to you? Or, I mean, it seems like now months ago, and you've gotten such acclaim for the film since then, but, like, people were just kind of targeting
you. Yeah,
well,
it was one L.A. Times guy, really.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, it was just, like, a drag. But, I mean, it's just written from the point of view of somebody who doesn't really understand
mm-hmm.
how this process works and who doesn't really want to respect... You know, who's not interested in the truth,
mm-hmm.
I guess, is really what it is. And also, it's, you know, when somebody badmouths somebody on a movie nowadays, it's such
right.
a rarity that, of course, he's got to use it. I mean, he has no
right.
choice. They're going to milk it for all they can. So
yeah.
it's fine, you know, whatever. But it was a drag because it was one of the first things that was written about the movie.
Right.
And it was just, like, so ridiculous. But anyway.
Is the outside stuff a big part of your world? I mean, do you pay attention to the reviews and to the box office and to the...
Well, yeah. Yeah, I mean, sometimes I feel like, you know, it's better to not... If you pay attention to a good review, then you're also likely to be somewhat open to a bad review.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it doesn't end up being... I don't know if it balances out.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I feel so much worse about a bad review than I feel good about a positive one. You know, I mean, I try not to get even that
right.
focused on. But I guess, yeah, I read the stuff.
Hard to get away from it.
Yeah.
Are there critics who you kind of are waiting for that you go, okay, that guy is kind of a good meter for me, or?
Well, I feel like there used to be critics where I knew this one hates me,
right?
This one really likes me. But over the years, now I've been doing this for 15 years or
mm-hmm.
something like that, and they've all gone every different direction. So there's no longer any really people who I really considered the people that that I know I'm going to get trashed by
mm-hmm.
are no longer. You know, I've had ups and downs with practically everybody, so I don't
mm-hmm.
know.
So obviously the Roald Dahl thing was a big appeal to you in this whole thing. I mean, you really immersed yourself in his universe.
Yeah.
In an almost very personal way, really.
Yes, it was very personal, you know, personal in being about him
mm-hmm.
As much as the book. We wrote at his house, and over the years I've gotten to know some members of his family quite well. I mean,
mm-hmm.
they've become good friends. And... And you know, we use. I would say it's as much about Dahl himself as it is an adaptation of the book,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of. I don't know if that's really true. It's sort of abstract. It's just we used a lot of. In the design of the movie, lots of it comes from his house and his land and
right.
his you know possessions, and we spent time there at his house and. You know, I just know his other work and his autobiographies, And I feel like that's a part of it, but I couldn't even say how specifically it is, you know? I mean, it's, but definitely we wanted it to be Roald Dahl.
Well, I actually was out there in England and, you know, I still think Mr. Beans kind of looks like Roald Dahl.
Yeah, well, but he is, he's based half on Dahl and half on Michael Gambon.
So that was the design of it.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. And although his some of his clothes are based on Richard Harris, actually. But yeah, it's a combination.
Which is just circumstance, or were you a Richard Harris fetishist?
No, I saw him on I saw him on David Letterman once, and he was wearing like a rugby shirt, open with a necktie. And I'd never seen anybody wear a, you know, it's like wearing a t-shirt with a tie. And so I kind of used that a little bit.
So is it the dichotomy, the core thing of this story, that is what draws you into it? I mean,
I think you know, what drew me into it, I guess, is that I read the book when I was very young. I loved the digging. I loved that they were they were spending all this time underground, and and it's also just, it's very well written, so I was completely gripped by the story. And I think I kind of liked that the hero of the story, he rescues, he saves them, but he also is really, his personality is causing all their problems in the first place. I think something about that kind of appealed to me, even then.
But watching it, we see you as a mild-mannered character, I guess, the person. I mean, we don't really all know you, but we see what we see of you. And yet, you know, there is the of the eating.
Yes.
Is that in you as well? I mean, is that a big part of your personality that we don't get to see? You tearing into your toast, wild abandon?
Well, definitely, while we were writing this, as we were working on it, without it being a plan, this concept of this character being sort of obsessed with being a wild animal, and some metaphor related to that became more and more a part of our version of the story. That's something that's not really, that doesn't come from the book.
Right.
That comes from our, me and Noah Baumbach and I writing, that comes from our personalities, I guess. And, you know, in the end, there's a scene near the end of the movie that's with, where they see this wolf, and it's, really has nothing to do with the plot at all. It has, it's a totally isolated thing, but I feel like it's the climax of the movie for some reason. That ended up being kind of what it was all about for me anyway. This sort of guy in corduroy who wants to be or doesn't want to lose contact with being with his wildness, I guess. I don't know. That's a long way of not answering the question, I guess.
Well, I mean, are you feeling after these 15 years or so that there is a theme or a sense of what a Wes Anderson movie is, or is that an outside perception?
It's probably better for me if it stays an outside perception, because the more I think about it, the more confused I get. I think, but that definitely I have the choice of saying, here are things that people can say, that's like what you've done before, and I can actively, aggressively avoid them and steer away from them, or I can say, what do I want to do? What would I like it to be? And I have these choices with this part of the story, and this one feels like the most powerful to me, or the most meaningful to me, but it also reminds me a lot of a scene between Gene Hackman and Angelica Houston, or something, and I have tended to say, I think I would rather just do what I like, and accept that there's might be some very clear threads and things that are going to connect my movies together, and that will be okay with some people and annoying to other people, I guess.
Well, Hackman is kind of like the classic example, because he also, doing Mamet, broke the, one of the actors who breaks the Mamet style. And even directed by Mamet, didn't do Mamet, quote unquote.
Yeah,
he was in Heist.
Heist, gosh, I forgot about Heist. Heist is like that Peter Yates movie.
Yeah.
There's a Peter Yates movie. It has a title like Heist. The gosh, I can't remember what it is. I don't remember what it is. A movie in the 60s. Yeah, I think maybe he did Heist right before he did the Royal Tenenbaums, in fact.
Yeah, you guys were the closing act, pretty much.
Yeah, you're right.
A tight little group. But, I mean, he also didn't... I mean, there's something about seeing Bill doing your work where Bill has a rhythm that seems to fit so perfectly that you get, you know, the voice fits, or Jason, where it's almost iconically... You know, your style is embodied by their rhythms.
Yeah.
Whereas somebody like Hackman seems to break away and find, you know, something else, some other poetry in the poetry.
Well, I wrote it for him. Mm-hmm. The part, he was the only guy who I wanted. I spent ages and ages trying to convince him to do it, and I loved, you know, even though he's not the gentlest person to work with, I mean, it's sometimes it's a bit it's just very emotional, but I just loved what he was doing every single day. Mm-hmm. So I felt like he's just I read something with Woody Allen saying that Gene Hackman was the only actor he's ever been intimidated by, mm-hmm. But that he feels that every word he says feels authentic, and that definitely was the case with me when I was doing it. And also, he would say, "Can I do it like this?" And it would be something really different than what I had in mind, mm-hmm. and it would be something, and I know it was always something very active, and he would just attack the scene, mm-hmm. And really what he wanted to do is attack the scene and have at the end of take one you say, perfect, that's it, we don't need to do this anymore. Mm-hmm. That's really, I think, how he would like it to be, anyway, yeah.
So I guess Clint is his perfect director.
Probably so, yeah. Brisk.
One and gone.
Yeah.
Set up.
Yeah.
Next setup. So does your core group, I mean, you have some regulars at this point. Is it this time though you worked with some people you hadn't really worked with before?
Yeah, well, like George Clooney and Meryl Streep, in terms of actors.
Yeah. So is that fun to go find new people as you go along? Is that a different experience?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, I feel like the last movie I did, we had Adrian Brody, that was who was new, right. And I've worked with so many people so many times. I'm so comfortable working with the same people. I want to make sure to not just use those people, because there are people who I know I'm going to want to keep using, and who I just love working with so much and admire. But I want to also have other voices in these movies. But both of them. I mean, George Clooney was almost. I feel like he was almost. He treated the movie as if he were one of the producers, you know? Mm-hmm. Not that he was working on it separately, he just made everything possible, you know? Mm-hmm. He was just up for anything, and you know, the first recording session for the movie was at a farm in Connecticut that belongs to friends of his who are also friends of my brother's. Mm-hmm. And you know, we kind of had a sort of summer camp trip together to this place, and I feel like, you know, it wasn't like we had 3 hours with George in a recording studio. He was there. He said, okay, whatever you need. And then for the next 2 years after that, every now and then we got together again or arranged one way or another to record new things. And also Meryl Streep was great. Yeah. Like, couldn't have been better. I mean, I just had the best time working with her too.
So putting them all together to shoot sound, shoot the audio in this movie, unusual for an animated film.
Yeah, yeah.
And what inspired you to go the different way?
I guess just, you know, I feel like the more, I always think, even though sometimes, it's not really how people think of my movie, but like when you bring up Gene Hackman, I feel like Gene Hackman is taking this thing that's sort of written in a slightly otherworldly way and is giving the sort of documentary version of it. Mm-hmm. That's what I like. That's what I want. And with this, I thought, well, the documentary way to get these performances, mm-hmm. I think, is to have everybody together and they can talk at the same time and anything that happens, happens. Mm-hmm. And if the scene is outdoors, let's be outdoors and there will be accidents. It was our chance to have accidents. Even though eventually I realized that the animation process is open to lots of, even the accidents just happen, they unfold slowly,
right.
But that doesn't mean you can stop them. Hmm. But this, you know, gave us a real spontaneity and, you know, I don't know where the idea came from, but it just seemed like the thing to do.
Was it like working on a picture? I mean, obviously there's not as much equipment around, but was it like setting up another movie?
It was a bit, you know, we were on location together, mm-hmm. So that's one thing that automatically feels like a movie. Everybody wakes up in the morning and, all right, let's look at what we're meant to do. But the thing is, it was more like a rehearsal, mm-hmm. Because people are holding their pages and they're wearing their regular clothes and they're, you know, there's no time doing the blocking and you go very, very quickly, mm-hmm. And I can just kind of tick off the moments that sounded right, and
right.
That's done. It's very free, you know. To record the right. voice separately is just so there are so many obstacles, mm-hmm. to spontaneity that are gone.
And so, did it feel different for you? I mean, did you make mistakes perhaps in thinking this would work and it didn't, or that it wouldn't work? And something did?
Well, the thing I definitely didn't anticipate, I thought we finished the script, and you know, we had been done for a while, we'd done mm-hmm. lots of revising and finessing, and it was done. And I thought, we're gonna now record the actors, and that's gonna be done. And then we're gonna storyboard it, and then we'll shoot it. Mm-hmm. But everybody told me, but when you do an animated film, you know, I think with most animated films, they start storyboarding and doing temporary recordings before they've even finished the script necessarily,
right.
And they keep revising the script with the storyboards and mm-hmm. Working through it. And I thought, well, that's not how we're doing it because
right.
We've already got the script. But that was exactly what happened. We started as soon as it was done, I started, this doesn't quite make sense. And all of a sudden you have mm-hmm. a freedom to not just edit it to figure out how you're going to solve your problems, you
right.
can say, well, you know what would actually be better is if these three scenes were just two lines,
right.
And rather than, you know, they don't even have to go over here, and in fact it might have more weight if we expanded this part of the story,
mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, you know, it becomes, you know, for 2 years,
right.
it's being rewritten and re-recorded and re-storyboarded, and you know, we even shot things that we changed, and
mm-hmm.
Probably more. It ended up being more than most animated movies because,
mm-hmm.
you know, we didn't have the option of saying let's go back and get some more money.
Right.
So we were definitely having to scramble around to
mm-hmm.
sort it all out, which we did. And I guess you always do that. But
so it's just you and Noah doing the rewriting as you went.
The rewriting I was on my own really because
okay.
Noah and I wrote this together. You know, years ago,
mm-hmm.
You know, he has a new movie
right.
already. You know, he's done during Mr. Fox. He's had two movies come out. So,
so in the traditional animation, it's usually a large group of men in a room, occasionally a woman. But you know, it's like a, you know, the old termite terrorist thing where there are, you know, 20 different people coming up with gags and
right.
doing all that. But you already had decided what the script was. It really.
Yeah.
The adjustments were more fine-tuning and.
Well, in fact, I wrote a lot of new scenes and we added characters and made a lot of changes, but you know, the thing with this kind of movie is there's time to work on everything. You know,
right.
we don't have 20 guys in the room, but I had time to
mm-hmm.
you know, to work on everything in it because, you know, there's really two solid years of one form of production or another.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a year of actual animation, but for the year before that, we'd already recorded, we'd
right.
edited, and we were designing things and testing things and all that kind of stuff.
So when you see a scene coming together, I mean, if you're on a set, you see it and you say print, and you go on, you kind of know what you have in the can. Here, obviously, it's a lot more complicated or time-consuming before you see what's in the can. How different was that for you?
Well, the way it is, you know, with a live-action movie, you're there on the set and something happens right there in front of you and you say, that was, you know, let's do the next thing. And your day is, you've got to do this one, you've got to do that one in order. Mm-hmm. And then the day is done and the sun has gone down or something's ended it and you finish the race. With this, a day is as many as 30 shots going simultaneously, mm-hmm. and none of them get finished probably that day. And at the end of the day, whatever time it is, 8:30 or whatever time, the shots are all done. All the questions are done for the day. Mm-hmm. Everybody's going home, except for the editorial gang, and they prepare the day's footage and send me dailies that last, you know, couple minutes, and okay. And of the couple minutes, only a little bit of them is actually new stuff. So I get okay. each shot with all the stuff I've already seen in the last week, plus the extra 2.5 seconds that mm-hmm. we just did, and I watch each of the ones, you know, kind of watching, and then at the end of the shot, leaning forward to see the new part, and sometimes, you know, something has gone wrong, mm-hmm. and then you can back up a little bit and fix it. Is it, my phone is buzzing? Is that going on the recording? No, it's not. Okay, sorry. sometimes there's a problem that you can correct. Right. Sometimes there's just a surprise that's interesting. And you have to discuss it and say, well, you know, this is not the animators' personalities mm-hmm. come into and you just don't know exactly. Even though the instructions are incredibly precise and you've gone over it and over it and over it and rehearsed mm-hmm. it. Still, there's still a lot of room for each animator to do it a different way, and mm-hmm. There's surprises there,
which is good, I would think. I mean, much like an actor,
it's a lot like an actor. It's a peculiar thing because it's like a half an actor, you know, and it's a very unique thing, mm-hmm. And it's generally. It's really exciting, and mm-hmm. some animators, you know, over the course of the movie, I got to know the personalities and the strengths of different animators, and we would sometimes say, you know, we do have an idea for this new shot,
right.
But there are only it has to be either this, it has to be Jason or Kim to do this particular thing or mm-hmm. whatever, Chuck to do this other thing, mm-hmm. You know, and they and you can take advantage of this of these. Special kind of, it's like the ability to cast your character based on the shot
right.
rather than the role, you know? It's an unusual
so
thing.
So you would actually to break through that, because I know in a lot of traditional animation, again, they, you know, there's a key animator for each character.
Well, with this, it's not like that because there's, there were like 12 Mr. Fox puppets, for instance.
Right.
Well, they're all working at once. So you know, there are going to be a lot of people doing him,
right.
And really, it's more. And then it's how do we schedule it? The scheduling is almost all based on not who is best for this shot or that shot. That figures into a certain point. There are
right.
these guys who are able to do this material,
mm-hmm.
but really the thing is, how do we make sure everybody's working? Nobody should be waiting, mm-hmm. You know, nobody should be waiting for this thing to finish so they can work. Everybody needs to be working, so we're always making progress.
Mm-hmm.
And then we say, but if there's any way that we could get Brad to do this, can we find that out? And mm-hmm. then, you know, there's on a stop motion movie, there's somebody who's sort of scheduling it,
right.
and. He's got this crazy jigsaw puzzle, and he's always moving the pieces around. And
so, do you have any sense of that when you went into doing it?
I didn't know anything about this stuff. You know, I'd done some stop motion before, but I didn't
right.
have any sense of how it. I had never been that close to it. You
right.
know, I was in Italy when we were animating in San Francisco,
mm-hmm.
and maybe it was animated more in Portland. I don't even know. Henry Selick.
Yeah, Henry Selick in Portland. Yeah,
yeah. yeah. And I would just get the shots when they were done,
mm-hmm.
and then if we tried to change it, we'd redo it. We spent a lot more money per second on
right.
that than this, thousands more.
Huh.
But you know, once we figured out a system, I really loved doing it. It was
right.
I had a great time doing
and
it.
And how long did it take you to figure out whose personality fit which thing?
That was months and months to really, mm-hmm. Because you sort of, I didn't even have the idea in mind about right. it. I thought they are all going to basically just animate this, you know, mm-hmm. they have these recordings, and it just didn't occur to me. I thought, figure somebody will be better and somebody right. will be not as good, but not that they will be, not simply that there's a better animator and a not right. as good animator, but first of all, what is it like when somebody's when it doesn't work
right
quickly okay. we got to see that because, you know, animators say, I think I lost it mm-hmm. somewhere here, and sometimes they're trying to hit exact things that have been, I mean, I might have given a lot of very detailed information, and sometimes when they're trying to work with some animators mm-hmm. to try to hit these exact movements and things, they'll lose the life of it and it will just get weird and then other animators really love that. They respond to that right. very well, and they can take anything you give them. And so some, and just the way an actor, some actors, it's better if you give them something general, and some actors like right. the more you give them, the better. They'll just kind of take it all in.
So is this kind of intense focus for you, you know, as you're getting the materials each day and going through them and finding, you know, such precision little things? Was that exciting? Was that a different headspace than you've been in, or?
Yeah, definitely a different headspace. Also, a lot of the time I was working from my apartment, mm-hmm. And you know, to be sort of like, it's like being in some kind of cockpit or something at my computer, and there's so many people that are working, mm-hmm. and there's so much communication. And also I had my editor with me. So mm-hmm. I have in the other room, you know, an editorial system, and he's right. in communication with that end, and it was very strange, you know. People would come to visit me, and it would just be like, "This is really weird. What's going on here?" Mm-hmm. Because really, it's me. Every hour or something, there'll be a moment where there's nothing, where suddenly I'm. There's a pause.
Right.
Everybody's working away, and nobody needs me for a moment. And I would sit there, and you know, like Owen came over there, and Owen was just like, "This is really weird. What's happening right now? What I just watched. What I just saw. You know, while he was reading his right. book, hearing me talking on the phone and answering these questions and doing all this stuff. but it was really fun.
Well, you hear from actors all the time talking about, you know, they see themselves working, and that, you know, they see this eyebrow go up, or they see a twitch or whatever, and it drives them crazy. Because they wish they could go back and fix that. And it sounds like you have that kind of level of micro focus as a director, which is hard.
You can have that, but you have to decide what's important and what is the thing that you're like, you know, there's something that you see, and what's the thing that in this moment you're like, that's not what we were saying, that's not what we were supposed to do. Mm-hmm. And then you think, but in the course of the movie, is that going to matter? Because we can only fix so many things, and we can right. only do so many shots. And you start to learn, you know what, this detail is just not, I have this idea of this detail, I want to get that. And we do it again, mm-hmm. and that detail is there. But this other thing that was in the first take is missing, and now you have two takes mm-hmm. that have taken 11 days instead of six, mm-hmm. And you're going to pick one,
right.
and you know, with a movie like this, you don't want to have the option to pick one. I mean, as soon as you have the option to pick one, you've misspent your time. There's something else that you could have done,
right?
Much
less make a third.
Yeah, much less make a third that combines them. So you know, in general, so eventually I started to realize, you know, like things that we were doing at the beginning that I was convinced not to redo, and later I was like, I wanted to redo that. We have so many bigger problems mm-hmm. now that to deal with, and you know, and I kind of had to go through a process of understanding how it all works.
So was there a moment where you finally saw the whole thing thrown together, or did you see it thrown together day by day by day by day?
Day by day, because what happens is, you know, we've edited the storyboards with the voices
right.
and done a lot of rewriting and reworking and redrawing, and we've basically ended up rethinking everything at some point along mm-hmm. the way, and tightening it up. And as you're going along with that, we did make this shot, so that gets right. replaced. So now there's storyboards and a real shot, and then more storyboards, and slowly the movie. But as you're going along, we were refining our editing continuously. And right. the strange thing is, you would never in a live action movie say, or almost never. It'd be great if Can we just make him pick up that cup quicker? You know, and with this, you are constantly editing within the shot, mm-hmm. and just pulling out frames, and you know, sometimes editing something out, editing out a moment without cutting away, right. because you can find a place for it. You know, it's just the nature of stop motion. There's room to pull frames and add frames and change things.
So you're watching it from stem to stern on a regular basis, and as things come in, they're filling in, or
yeah, but I think we tended to watch it. We had divided it into reels, which is not even necessary, you know, now because it's right. like digital stuff, and there's no reels, just aren't meaningful. And the,
right.
But we had it in reels just because. I said, well, shouldn't we go into reels? And my editor, Annie, was like, all right, we can put it in reels. So we would watch reels usually, mm-hmm. And watch scenes every now and then, try to watch the whole thing. But it takes a long time before you can watch the whole thing and not really feel depressed. You know, it takes months before you're at a point where you think, oh, well, maybe this is going to work.
So it's constantly like watching the first assembly of a live action movie.
Yes, yeah, it is. And especially since so much of it is not moving,
right?
You know, it can be very boring, mm. and you just think, how's this gonna work?
It's not, but it does somehow.
Yeah, it does eventually.
So what was the moment where you kind of felt like we're a few more refinements, but we're basically there?
Yeah, I think I don't remember. I think there was a point when we you know, every now and then we'd send the studio, here's what mm-hmm. we've got so far. And at some point along the way, you know, whenever we would do that, we would end up, you know, working all night for a couple of days, mm-hmm. and which you kind of need to do at a certain point in a movie. And right. this gave us a reason to do it. After one of those, you know, we felt like we kind of had it. Mm-hmm. And because also, you know, I was kind of trying to decide how much. You know, there were some things like is it too violent, mm-hmm. or is it all right that they're saying there's all this cuss stuff?
Right.
How much are we going to say that? And eventually, there was a moment when I realized we're just doing it exactly. We're not listening to it. There's no way to absorb anything else. We've got right. to just make this the thing it's meant to be. Mm-hmm. And I do remember kind of a moment when I was sure that that was the way to go with it. I mean, at least where I thought.
Right.
It was the way to go with it. I don't know if it was the way to go with it, but, you know.
And for you as a director, what is your moment where you're finished, as it were? I mean, we talk to people who are finished when, you know, they finish shooting, when they're finished in post, or when they go through the whole marketing and distribution and award season and all of that.
Yeah.
When are you checking out?
a bit like the last one. I mean, I definitely don't feel like I've disengaged from it until there is a, you know, until we have finished the color timing or the color correction,
right.
and you know, until we have you know, the sound mix 100%, because you know the scoring can be a very intense period that's almost like the shooting, and mm-hmm. and you know, with this one it was a long process, and there was a lot of kind of refining in post,
mm-hmm.
even though post is very short period. Mm-hmm. It was an intense short period because it's edited already during
right.
the shooting. But then seeing the movie, trying to take it into the theaters,
mm-hmm.
is very. It's I think like the Coen brothers, whenever their movies are being released, they usually are saying, and you know, we've just finished shooting this other one. You know,
right. They
always seem like they're so far ahead of where
yeah.
I am. But
well, No Country, they were at Toronto and started shooting the next week.
They did.
On the next movie, yeah.
Yeah, which means they've got the script done, they've got it cast,
yeah.
they've got it prepped, they've got everything ready. I've never been able to get, I've always had to kind of finish the whole thing. And mm-hmm. you know, it's got to have come out in Brazil and Japan and you know, Sweden before I really feel like I can, okay, now I need to start working on this other thing.
And are you reading temperatures in each of those places? When you go to Brazil, are you sitting in the theater waiting to hear where they laugh? And
well, I don't know. I've never been to Brazil, in fact. but I definitely more and more I want to make sure we're getting the most out of every, you know, every country. Because mm-hmm. You know, like I did go to Sweden with the last movie, and I loved it. And I got much more into the translations and things like that over the last few years. Mm-hmm. And you know, Darjeeling Limited made twice as much money in the rest of the world as it made in America.
Right.
You know, and it did better in the rest of the world than any other movie I've done.
Mm-hmm.
And it did worse than any other movie I've done in America, except for Bottle Rocket, the first mm-hmm. one I did. So anyway, I think it's important for me just how the movie's being presented in the rest of the world.
And what is that experience like for you? I mean, at this point, you obviously are established. You're your own genre in a way. And yet, you know, something like Darjeeling happens and it's, you know, the expectations are through the roof. And then the audiences just didn't, you know, they just didn't find the marketing hook, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. For me, there's no answer. There's just, you know, a hope for the best. And you know, and now I've seen it go so many different ways that I'm just like, we have no idea. You know,
So is that a relief on some level? I mean, is that you?
No. Not at all.
So it's very it's hard.
It's hard because, you know, it really is like at the time of the movie, this is everything.
Mm-hmm.
But you really have no idea how it's going to play out. And the first steps of it, you know, mm-hmm. you can get very good reactions from the first critics who are seeing it. And,
right.
you know, with that one, we were... You know, it was in the opening night of the New York Film Festival, and mm-hmm. we were excited and felt like everything was going well. But then, when it actually came out in the theaters, it just didn't. Other than in New York and Los Angeles, but in America, people just didn't go see it. So that's a drag.
But it's been interesting that your films sometimes you think they're not going to do business, and they have done business.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I mean, Tenenbaums being the, you know, I guess the biggest domestic hit
yeah.
of the group. But it was like a really real Christmas movie. It was not, you know, it was not an art house movie at all.
Yeah, no, I know.
And is that important to you? I mean, is being mainstreamed part of your view of yourself, or do you care?
Well, I don't know if it's part of my view of myself, but it's definitely the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
If it can happen. You know, I mean, the movies are just, they are... There's no real distinction for me with the way we know with the choices of the movie.
Right.
So then it's just do more people see it or fewer people see it? I vote more.
And do you feel like a genre unto yourself? I mean, a Wes Anderson movie is definitely a Wes Anderson movie. On the other hand, some of the French films are more, you know, you see more of a natural fit into the French cinema.
Well,
the American.
I definitely think that I've always struggled to say what genres I, you know, I mean, even the broadest ones of comedy and drama, I've never really fit into one or the other. So,
mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Do you see yourself? I mean, do you see yourself being unique in American cinema in that way, or are you just doing the job, just doing the work you want to do?
I think more of the latter.
Because it's too horrifying to do the former.
Yeah, I don't know. Some of my favorite filmmakers as role models mm-hmm. are Pedro Almodovar and the Coen brothers and Ingmar Bergman. You know, I mean, I love Martin Scorsese. That's one of my favorite filmmakers of all time.
Mm-hmm.
But he has worked in such a broad range of kinds of movies and scales of movies, and mm-hmm. that's part of what he's wanted to do, is to say, I can do something that's like this, and I can do something like this,
mm-hmm.
and I can do genres, and I can do something that has no genre. And but for me, I think I feel a bit more suited for the other filmmakers. I mean, something more like what they do, which is their movies are just always very close to themselves. They write them,
mm-hmm.
And they those movies really come directly out of their lives. And they, Pedro Almodovar, Ingmar Bergman, they have this kind of nice advantage of being regional
mm-hmm.
and being, you know, I think that serves them or has mm-hmm. served them in some ways.